introduction is perhaps excessive. There is perhaps no issue in Pakistan which excites more emotion and excitement than the nuclear issue. And I should say that outside of Pakistan, nuclear weapons have given to Pakistan a very special place. That's not a place that's always nice. In fact, it's not a nice place that they get. But then these are issues that need to be understood, to be thrashed out in public discussion. Today we have three speakers who have often written and spoken on the issue of nuclear weapons and Pakistan. They are people who have sometimes represented the country and its nuclear position, or they have helped create or defend the nuclear national narrative. They are Dr. Zafar Iqbal Chima, who got his PhD from the War Studies Department at the University of London, King's College, the University of London. This Dr. Zulfiqar Khan, who has just published a book. It's called Pakistan's Nuclear Posture. He teaches at the National Defense College in Islamabad. And we have a speaker from the previous session, now needs no further introduction, Mr. Mahmoud Sheikh, former Foreign Secretary of Pakistan. All KLF speakers are, of course, at liberty to say what they want, how they want, but not as long as they want. That's pretty much limited to 10 minutes. 11, if you're generous. Before I invite them, before I invite the first speaker, I would want to put before them and all of you three key nuclear questions. Questions that have bothered my mind, questions that should bother your mind as well. And questions whose answers I would dearly love to have. First, I'd love to know what nuclear weapons have done for Pakistan. At the time of the nuclear test in May of 1998, it was said that nuclear weapons would give to the country permanent security and stability. But unless I am wrong on this, Pakistan today appears less confident of its security and stability than at perhaps any other time in the past. In 1998, army officers would proudly walk out into the public and they would be respected and saluted. Today they cannot wear their uniforms in public by official orders because of the threat to their lives. Today we have blockades and barricades in Islamabad, the heart of Pakistan. Today we have a massive insurgency in Balochistan. And if you look at what the world is saying about us, it's saying that, well, we may not be a failed state, but we certainly are not a successful state. So I would like to know from the speakers, what have nuclear weapons done for Pakistan? A second question would be, it is said that Pakistan has the world's fastest growing nuclear arsenal. It is said to have now upwards of 100 or 120 warheads. And shortly, if this rate of growth is maintained, our nuclear arsenal will exceed that of Britain's. Pakistan has not denied it. At the same time, Pakistan has almost single-handedly blocked the missile material cut-off negotiations in Geneva at the conference of disarmament. So, my question to the distinguished speakers will be, does this mean that Pakistan has decided to become an outlier? And if it has, what are the costs that will have to be paid for this position? My third and last question, and I hope this will also be addressed by them, none of them have, is that as we gather over here, for what, maybe a couple of hundred people, well, there will be probably 200,000 people at the Defy Pakistan rally at the Pyramid Bazaar today. At that Defy Pakistan rally, there will be half a second of the Lashkar-e-Taiba, Jamaat-ul-Dawa, whatever. There will be other organizations that have been banned by the government of Pakistan earlier. Lashkar-e-Taiba is the organization that carried out the Mumbai attacks. And now all this has something very much to do with nuclear weapons. Because groups that have been nurtured and received sustenance on the soil of Pakistan have felt secure because they had the protection of nuclear weapons behind them. This is what accounted for the Kargil episode in 1998-99. This is what perhaps accounted for the 13th of December attack 2001 on the Indian Parliament. And when Mumbai took place, although India wanted to retaliate, it could not because of Pakistan's nuclear weapons. So my question is, has the Pakistani military establishment now decided that by setting Lashkar-e-Taiba on the loose, that it wants more Mumbai's? And does it still believe that nuclear weapons are going to be a permanent and total deterrent to any Indian action, including that of Operation Cold Star? These are tough questions. As I said, you are at liberty to ignore all of them or address some of them, and I shall be most interested in your answers. So with that, I shall invite Dr. Zafar Iqbal Chima to give his